Howdy, how's it going? My name's Davy Chappie, and I like digging holes. One race of people who share that trait with me are the ever-stoic dwarves, who dig holes to merry tunes not just via mining, but also by holding on to every grudge that they've ever been given because not one slight is too small for these fucking hairy meatballs to spite the world over. And also by mining! In my time, I've played many dwarves. In fact, my first 1-20 campaign was with a dwarf, so you know I'm coming from a place of well-learnedness when I say that choosing your class for this race is actually pretty easy. But I need to fulfill my weekly quota of showing my face to the world to prove that I'm not dead, so as always, keep in mind that the majority of this video is just my opinion. So if you don't think that dwarves in real life would become oil barons, fracking the ocean surface for its crude wealth, feel free to play your games however you want. But with that out of the way, let's begin. So your basic dwarf has a lot going for it. A natural +2 to con, which is universally good, standard issue dark vision, poison resistance, a free tool proficiency with smith, brewers, or mason's tools, free proficiency with axes and hammers, and an annual subscription to the history of rock and roll. Tool proficiency is nice because nobody gets all of them, so you'll always be benefiting.
Check Xanathar, I swear to God.
But if you're a regular to the channel, you know that the weapon proficiency will be all but useless. Martial classes already have better weapon proficiencies, and magic classes don't need them because cantrips exist. You also have the problem of little stubby legs, so the dwarf's reduced speed means that you'll want to compensate for that, or else get used to always ending up 5 feet short of all your problems. Ways to fix this include the mobile feet or squat nimbleness, which can explicitly be used for dwarves, but since this video is all about class combinations, it should be noted that the barbarian and the monk both benefit from a natural movement speed increase, as well as the Blade Singing Wizard and a few other miscellaneous subclass features. But these are your main classes. There's also the Rogue with their endless bonus action dash, but the Rogue can use its bonus action to do other things, and if it wants to do them, it'll run into the problem of no longer being swifty. I should also bring up that tool proficiency again, because while most classes will pick up brewing skills and think, huh, neat, the Artificer grows exponentially more powerful once it hits 6th level and gains tool expertise, because it doubles its proficiency when it uses any of its tools. And like I said, check the eyeball book if you want to know exactly what all those tools are capable of. All these other abilities are universal, so I don't think your class is going to be affected by a conspicuous alcohol tolerance, and honestly, almost all of the dwarf subraces give universally good benefits, so your choice will mostly come down to what ability score you get, which is why I recommend using Tasha's optional rules on the dwarf more than any other race in the game. It's like the only thing holding any class back from playing a dwarf. As for the first subclass, the Hill Dwarf reigns supreme as the most basic and uninteresting race option you could take, getting a whopping 1 extra health per level. That's it. Literally, the +2 to con from the base dwarf will already give you that and more. Just use Tasha's to bend the wisdom bonus to whatever you want, and then forget this subclass ever existed. Or take it if you plan on being the healthiest boy who ever ate his greens. The mountain dwarf is strictly worse than the hill dwarf, or at least it was before Tasha's came out. When we were told that Tasha's Cauldron of Everything would come with the optional rule of shuffling around your ability score increases so that you could play what you want, some people got upset because purism. Those people are dumb, but some of those people also tried to lift up the mountain dwarf as the smoking gun for how people could abuse the system, because the mountain dwarf happens to be the only subrace that gets an additional +2 to an ability score on top of the +2 that comes from the remain race. Under normal circumstances, this would be pretty impressive, if it weren't for the fact that the only other thing that the mountain dwarf gets is proficiency in light and medium armor, which is completely useless. Like with weapon proficiencies, if you plan on playing a class that wants to make use of their armor, your class will have already provided you with that armor. And if you're playing a squishy spellman, you will have mage armor, or some variation thereof, or at best, you can forgo casting one spell slot per day so that you can look fancy in your half blade and wizard hat. The end result is that getting an additional +2 is the only good thing about the mountain man, and it's a neat thing, yeah, but you know what you're trading off in exchange for it, and that's literally any subrace features. No one played the mountain dwarf before Tasha's anyway, and now that the book came out, I still don't see it happening. Play what you want, but if you want a dwarf with actual abilities, might I suggest the Mark of Warding dwarf. It's got that Eberron flair to it, which means it gets a bunch of extra spells that you'll only get if you play a spellcaster, plus an extra D4 when you make an investigation check or try to use thieves' tools. And you get one free casting of Alarm, Mage Armor, and Arcane Lock. Alarm is a spell that I don't go out of my way to take, but having it with me on the go is always fun. Mage Armor means that this subclass is strictly better than the Mountain Dwarf's proficiencies, because Mage Armor is better than every type of light armor. And Medium Armor can give only a +2 to dex, whereas Mage Armor is light and flexible, so your dex mod can go all the way to the moon. Arcane Lock is a spell that I've mentioned in other videos as being deceptively useful, since you can lock the door behind enemies, and being the slowest in the bunch, you'll probably be the last one out anyway. The end result is that obviously mages will get better mileage out of this dwarf, considering half of the spells are restricted to simply being added to a spell list. But it also means that casters which wouldn't normally have access to Nock or Armor of Agathys suddenly have an avenue to it without having to spend a feat for it. And while a full caster will obviously get to those spells faster, there's nothing wrong with a ranger or a paladin taking the Mark of Warding. The only thing I wouldn't do is take the Eldritch Knight or the Arcane Trickster, because both of them use a wizard spell list which get all of these spells already, and they also learn spells up until level 4, so they're they're not even getting the full retinue. That said, if you don't play a caster at all, I still wouldn't shy away from the subrace. The D4 on Investigation and Thieves' Tools isn't bad, and the free spells like Arcane Lock and Mage Armor are still spells that you can cast no matter what. They at least beat out your other choices of getting one extra hit point or some useless proficiency bonuses. But if magic is what you're looking for and the Mark of Warding isn't doing it for you, then dim the lights and pull out the Duergar. What they lack in an easily pronounceable name, the Duergar make up for in twice the Dark Vision, resistance against illusions, charms, and fear by way of being so anti-emotions that they simply refuse to be tricked by their own brains because that would be considered tomfoolery, and they get two innate spells in the form of invisibility and a special enlarge reduce that can only be casted on themselves and only to enlarge, causing hundreds of DeviantArt accounts to sweat. As far as classes go, none of the Duergar's abilities lean in any particular direction, so the only thing that you have to worry about is the reason why nobody ever plays an Underdark character: sunlight sensitivity. Sunlight sensitivity is a scary trait that the Duergar share with their drow counterparts, which forces disadvantage on attack rolls if either you or your target are in direct sunlight. It also gives disadvantage on perception, but I am here to tell you that that is not a big deal. The amount of time that you'll spend in the sun varies from campaign to campaign, but if a fight breaks out in a tavern, in a cave, in a forest, in a tundra, underwater, at night, in fucking space, or in one of the many alternate planes of existence where the sun TM is not an issue, then you'll never have to worry about it. I personally know of at least 4 different adventures where you will never run into this problem. And even if you're not playing in one of those, there are a few secret ways to fix it. The first and most simple: play a spellcaster and take saving throw spells. Saving throws are unconcerned with the whims of disadvantage, and pretty much every caster has them. Even the ranger and the paladin, who normally would have to resort to stabbing if they ran out of spell slots, get new options in Mommy Tasha's that allow them to take cantrips as a fighting style, so if you need a damage alternative that doesn't make you roll, then you're in luck. Besides that, your other options include taking the mounted combatant feat and riding a dire pony to cancel out the disadvantage with advantage, or you could cast spells that put you in dim light or darkness, some of which come with the added difficulty of limiting your own range of actions if you can't see through it yourself, or you could simply wear an extra large hat and constantly fight under its cover, which technically meets the qualifications, but it runs into its own complication of you still being too short to lift the brim over your enemy. The main takeaway from sunlight sensitivity is you should check to see what the likelihood of being in direct sunlight is gonna be, and if you think that it is going to be an issue, then you could just play a spellcaster and enjoy all the benefits of having your own self-activated inflation mechanic. But that'll about do it. I hope you enjoyed this video. Be sure to leave a like, comment, subscribe, ring the bell, and check out all my social media in the description below, and maybe support me on Patreon so that I can continue to redo the list of races that I have already done before. But yeah, Davy out.